All right, well, good morning, everyone. This I recall to mind, therefore I hope it is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed. His compassion fail not. It is new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your ways to him, trust in him, and he will do it. For we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love him, to those who are called according to his purpose. Before we get started with our worship this morning, we always like to spend a few moments to prepare ourselves to make sure that we are in fellowship with God. Fellowship with God is broken anytime we commit a personal sin in what we think, what we say, and what we do. But God and his grace have already provided the means by which we can restore fellowship with him when fellowship is broken. In 1 John 1:9, we read, "When we confess our sin, God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and clean us from all unrighteousness." So in preparation for our worship this morning, let's spend a few moments of silent prayer to confess our sin. And then we'll begin with a scripture reading and then worship and song. With that being said, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful to have this opportunity to come together to learn your word and to worship you in spirit and truth. We ask of you, not because of our confession, but because of what Christ did for us over 2,000 years ago, that you would clean us from all sin so that we can be controlled and filled by your spirit, who teaches us and make the things that we're about to learn understandable. He also made the things that we're about to learn applicable to our lives. He gives us the power we need to apply your truth. So we ask of you to clean us so that we can fellowship and be restored to your divine power. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. If you will, open your Bible in preparation for our worship to Genesis chapter 2. Verse 15 through 17. Throughout the Bible, God makes promises which reveals his interaction with man and his plan of redemption. Throughout the Bible, God makes promises which reveals his interaction with man and his plan of redemption. And what I wanted to do in preparation for our study today or this morning is to look at promises in the Word of God as God interact with man and furthering his plan of redemption. So if I can have someone to read for me, Genesis chapter 2, verse 15 through 17. Here we have the first promise God makes man. The first promise God makes man. So someone read, if you will.
The Lord God commanded man. And the Lord commanded man. But
so here we see God's first promise to man. And in this promise, he promised that if man choose to go his own way, the consequence of choosing to go your own way and disobedient will be death. And death here is not necessarily physical death. Death here is a separation from God. And as you know, Adam disobeyed God. He chose to go his own way. And at that moment, he became spiritually dead or separated from fellowship with God. And that is also called the fall of man. But then God in his faithfulness and his grace in Genesis 3:15, after the fall of Adam, here we have another promise. Genesis 3 verse 15. And someone read, if you will, when you get there.
I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel.
Here we have God's redemptive promise after man fell into sin. Here we see God promising a suffering Messiah, a Messiah who will crush the head of the serpent, but also defeat sin and death, therefore providing salvation for man. And then in verse 21 of the same chapter, we see a picture of this redemption through the blood of the animal. Someone read, if you will, verse 21. Okay, see, here is a picture of what God is going to do in the future. Through a lamb, he will provide redemption through the shed blood of the lamb. This is God doing what man cannot even do for himself. Adam and Eve had tried to cover their sin through fig leaves. But God did not accept their covering, and therefore he decided to kill an innocent animal and clothe them with the animal skin. In other words, without the shed and the blood, there is no forgiveness for sin. So here we see God promises, reveals his redemptive plan for man. Said, though man fail, in disobeying God, God promised to defeat sin one day yet future. And then he gave a picture of the fulfillment of that promise when he killed the innocent animal. Man deserved to die, but God used something that was innocent to provide a solution for man's problem. And so I thought to read that this morning as we contemplate the faithfulness of God. God is faithful because he, even though we had sinned, a man had sinned, God promised to redeem man. And all throughout the Old Testament and New Testament, you see promise after promise of God demonstrating his faithfulness. See, God is faithful to his promises. Whether it's promises to curse man for sin or whether it's promises to bless man for obedience. When we begin our Old and New Testament survey, we will see more of God's promises because these promises reveal the faithfulness of God. Right now, if y'all can stand, we will begin in worship and song.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have need thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord. Summer and winter, Springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and star in their courses. Join with nature in man for it to thy great faithfulness, mercy. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thine hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Straight for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Thank you.
seated. He that spared not his own son, but gave him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? Well, in our first section, we're going to resume our study of understanding and knowing God. As you all know, I thought I was done with this study, but we are currently looking at the decree of God, the decree of God. If you will, open your Bibles to Daniel chapter 4, verse 34 through 35. Daniel chapter 4, 34 through 35. Daniel chapter 4, 34 through 35. Before we read this, let me define for you the decree of God. As I stated on last week, the decree of God is the unchangeable, eternal, wise, holy, and sovereign purpose of God, comprehending all things that ever were or will be and determining their futurition or what will be future events. I say that again. God's divine decree is his unchangeable, eternal, wise, holy, and sovereign purpose. He comprehended all things that ever will be and everything that were, and to determine what he will allow to become future events. So every event you see in human history, God have already saw those events before they actually became events, and he only allowed events to become events that he wanted to allow to become an event. And he allowed man's free will to coexist with his sovereign plan. In Daniel 4, 34 through 35, God, through discipline Nebuchadnezzar, calls him to realize this truth. Let's read starting at verse 34. But the end of the period, I, Nebuchadnezzar, raised my eyes toward heaven, and my reason returned to me, and I blessed the Most High, and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from all generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing, but he does according to his will in the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. And no one can ward out his hand or say to him, what have you done? God can do whatever he want to do without any round the table discussion. And Nebuchadnezzar had to learn the hard way that truth. He was king because of the sovereign will of God. God decreed, he saw that Nebuchadnezzar will become king way before he became king. And he allowed him to be king, even though he done a lot of evil things. God knew that as well in advance. And he allowed it because he's going to use even his free will to serve and further his plan. So there's never a time in human history where things are out of control. A president or become any foreign leader or foreign king, God have allowed that person to be king, but he also allowed that person the free will to choose for and against them. He will use that nation or that king to judge other nations. Then he'll turn right around and judge that nation when that nation is not using his free will to respond to his plan. So ultimately, he is in control, but he allowed man's sovereign will to coexist with his perfect will. Go to Acts 17, verse 24 through 28. Acts 17, verse 24 through 28. Acts 17, 24 through 28. Verse 24 of Acts 17, read, "The God who made the world and all the things in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hand, nor is he served by human hand, as though he needed anything, since he himself give to all people life and breath and all things." See, men may think they have some kind of control, but they don't. They fool themselves. God has sovereign control, and he only allowed men to have control. And he can always remove them from power whenever he wants to, and no one would say to God, "Who do you think you are?" He does what he will. See, in eternity past, God's sovereignty guarantees the futurition of all events, but he does not directly cause all events. Let me say that again. God's sovereignty guarantees the events that will become future events, but he does not directly cause all events. His decree established what will be caused. So in other words, in his all-knowing, he sees in the past everything that's going to become events in the future, and he's going to allow what he won't allow to become event, even though some of the event that he allow is going to be man using his free will for evil purposes. He even going to allow that because he's going to use it to serve his purpose. He determined before anything exists which thing will become historical events. He doesn't cause certain events and action because he allows free will to exist. God do not call certain events to happen. What the world became after Adam's sin was not God's perfect will. But because he allowed men the freedom to choose for and against him, he knew in advance that the possibility of giving man this freedom is going to mean man may bring chaos in the world. He doesn't cause certain events and action because he allowed free will to exist, but he does not interfere with the exercise of man's free will, even though he's in sovereign control. God even determined in eternity past that angels and men would have free will and that it will coexist with his perfect sovereign will. He knew that the world he knew that evil is possible when angels and men have the freedom to choose for and against him. He already knew that in advance, what was possible, he gave man freedom. He knew what would happen if man choose, or if angel choose, or if man choose against his plan. He saw it in advance. But he was willing to give man freedom. He don't want to force any of his creatures to choose for and against him. For him. He wants them to have the freedom to choose for or against him. And he know if they have freedom, what the possibility may be. But he still has a plan. He does not desire evil. He does not desire sin. You know what he desired? He desired for his perfect will to be done. That's what he desired. And it's always good. But because of free will, man chooses to function on his own will rather than the will of God, which is designed for his blessing. Even sin is a result of angels and men deciding to use their free will contrary to the will of God. God allows sin to be part of what he allows, though he doesn't approve of it. He don't approve of sin. He don't approve of evil. He don't approve of the thing that people do to little children. He don't approve none of the thing that's going on. Why those things going on in the world? Because man have chosen to function, operate contrary to the will and the plan of God. He knew that we would sin if we were given a choice. So he allowed the consequence of our choice. But after the fall of man, he didn't have to do it. In grace, he made a decree to provide redemption solution for men in the mess that he have created. He didn't have to do it. It was our fault. It wasn't his fault, but we love to blame God and say, "Oh, this is God. It's the woman's fault. God, if you would not have gave me that woman, it was you that gave me the woman." It wasn't the woman's fault. It wasn't God's fault. It was our fault. It was man's fault. We always like to find somebody to blame instead of taking responsibility of our own action. Again, though God's decree was planned in the eternity path to save fallen man, free will again, man must choose to accept God's plan of redemption to be saved from the penalty of his sin, which is death. God does not desire to cast creatures into the lake of fire at the end of human history, but it is decreed as certain for all men who reject Jesus Christ as their Savior. God have already decreed in eternity past that man gonna do this. As a result of him doing that, here's what's gonna happen. I'm gonna provide, make a provision, and they're gonna still be faced with the choice, would they accept my way out of the penalty of their sin? Go to 2 Peter 3:9, if you will. 2 Peter 3:9. Second Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing. Here's God's will. I don't wish for any to perish. I want all men to come into repentance. I want all men to change their mind about my son, Jesus Christ. That's what I want. That is my will. But guess what? Man has a choice to choose my way out of the penalty of their sin or choose not. So here we see that God does not desire to cast anybody into the lake of fire. But because of free will, some will spend eternity separated from God in the lake of fire. Here's another thing. God does not desire to give any of us a butt whipping. I call it divine discipline, divine butt whipping. God does not desire to discipline any believer in Jesus Christ. That is not his desire. And a lot of believers don't like to hear about God's discipline. But he have already decreed as certain for all believers who are in reversionism. What is reversionism? Reversion is when you revert back to your old lifestyle of sin and rebellion against God. When you live in perpetual carnality, that's reversionism. That's why I call it reversionism. It's when you revert back to your old unbelieving lifestyle. God don't desire to discipline his children that have reverted back to their old lifestyle as an unbeliever. He don't desire to discipline them, but he already decreed that I would discipline all my children who are in perpetual carnality, who choose not to restore fellowship with me. Some people think that because God is love, he'll never allow me to have misery in my life. That ain't from God. That's from the devil. The devil is doing that. No way, Jose. God's justice desires to bless you. But his righteousness must be satisfied in order for him to do that without compromising his own character. So God is not going to compromise his own character just because he loves you. He's righteous, meaning he rejects when a believer is living in perpetual carnality or living in reversionism. That is not his plan. He wants to bless that believer, but he can't do it until he satisfies his own integrity. In other words, I can't bless him until I satisfy my righteousness. So guess what? I got to take my belt off. I got to give him a divine butt whipping. But many believers, they don't understand how God operates. They think that just because he's a loving God, that he's not going to allow them to have a miserable life. But when you're in perpetual carnality as a believer, you choose not to get in fellowship, choose not to get down with God's plan because he wants to bless you. But he can't do it without satisfying his righteousness and his justice. So whatever his righteousness don't accept, his justice have to judge it. But in love, you provide a way of escape. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and clean us from, that's your way of escape from divine butt whipping. Confess your sin. Confess your sin and come back to God and get serious about learning and applying his word. And then cursing turns into blessing. Then he restores you. So he already decreed it, that the lake of fire for those who reject my son, Jesus Christ. Divine discipline for those who have believed in my son, but yet they go back to their old unbelieving lifestyle of sin, serving self, and living life independently of me. I got to discipline them because I want to bless them. And I can't bless them until I satisfy my righteousness. So guess what? Divine butt whipping is actually God's love in action. Hey, parents, you know how it goes. You discipline your kids. Why? Because you love them. You love them. You skin them alive. Now, they don't think it at the moment. They don't think you love it. They think you're the most horrible person in the world for disciplining them. But God disciplined us because he loves us. And he knows that we cannot enjoy his blessing without doing something to put pressure on us to get us to come back to the place of blessing. I call it the place, the palace. A lot of us like living in the dungeon. But God said, I need to do something to get you back to the palace. You're a king's child. You are a royal priest. You are the child of God. Why are you there in the hog pen? Why are you in the mud? Let me get you out of the mud. It's called divine butt whipping. God justly desires to bless you, but his righteousness must be satisfied. God would not hesitate. Don't get it mistaken. He would not hesitate. I take that back. He's a little patient with us, more than we are with others. But God will not hesitate to discipline you if you stay out of fellowship for long periods of time. Your choice. And then when we stay out of fellowship for long periods of time and all this misery come in our life, we want to say, why did God allow this to happen to me? God did not do that. You did that. You did that. You made the choice to stay out of fellowship for long periods of time. You chose to live contrary to the will of God as he reveals it in his word. So he is just. You can't say he's not fair for allowing this to happen to me. No, you chose that. You chose to function on your free will contrary to his will revealed or his desire revealed in his word. You know, people, they get married. And they marry some guy for the wrong reason. And then he start giving her black eyes. And that they're going to say, God, why? But where are you allowed this to happen to me? Why are you allowed me to marry this person? Allow that person? No. You did not want to listen to the word of God that say, don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. And therefore, you're getting, you did that. Now, God is solution, but he didn't do it. Your choices did it. He did not allow us to exist or have free will, y'all, to glorify ourselves, but he gave us free will to glorify him. I want to share just a couple of things or a few categories of God's will. So there's three categories of God's will called the direct will of God, the permissive will of God, and the overruling will of God. The direct will of God is God stating in his word what he desires from us. That's the direct will of God. The permissive will of God is when God allows us to go our own way. Even though the consequence of going our own way was not his perfect will, because of free will, he permit us to go our own way. But then you have the overruling will of God, where sometimes God will overrule, thank him for this, your decision. He will overrule our decision, not letting us have the intended results of our decision in order to protect us, and also in order to protect the rest of mankind from our negative attitude toward his plan for our life. Thank the Lord for that, because I've been many times where he allowed me to go my way, and sometimes he'll step in and say, you know what? And I'd be praying for certain things. I'd be saying, Lord, can I have this? You know, I want to go my own way and go total away from the will of God. Then God sometimes will overrule my will, because it will be detrimental to me, and also be detrimental to others. And therefore he overruled it for my own good and to protect the human race from my decision as I choose to oppose his plan. The fall of man was not God's direct will. That is not what God desired, but he allowed it or permitted. That's his permissive. It was his permissive will, because he decreed in the past that man would have free will. So free will is the reason for sin and even the world. Now the cross of Jesus is the direct will of God. That was God's desire, is for his son to go to the cross and provide redemption for fallen man. That was God's direct will. Okay, now what was the end goal? What is the end goal of God's decree? All that God have decreed to take place in the future, what is the ultimate goal? What is God trying to arrive at? What is the end goal of what God have decreed to take place? Well, here's this. Our decree, send every event to bring all the creation under the rulership of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is the ultimate goal. One day, all the created order will be brought under the rulership of his son, Jesus Christ. That is the end goal of the plan of God, of all that God has decreed. Now, man can try to fight against that, but what God have decreed, no, as I said, no one can stay off God's hand and prevent God from doing what he have decreed to happen. So for us, since we know that God have, that's the ultimate goal, is to bring all the creation order up under the rulership of Jesus, as believers in Jesus Christ, we should be cooperating with God's plan of what God have decreed. How do we do that? Submit to the will of God. Don't fight his will for your life or what he desires for you. Now, when you believe in Jesus Christ, you are part of the family of God. But while you're on earth, we need to live as though Jesus is who he is and who he's going to be, as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. How do you live out that truth? By stop doing your own thing. Is submit to his desires for your life in the word. See, Jesus is already the Lord. I can't make him Lord. He's already Lord. But what I could do while I'm on earth is allow him to be Lord in my life by learning his word and submitting to his will for my life. We'll stop right here. We'll continue our study of 1 John after a 10-minute break. With that being said, let me ask Brother Johnny to close us out in prayer. We'll come back. We'll take a little break, and we'll come back in 10 minutes for our second section. Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for your words, for the promises that come in, nature as we fail, you never do. And your redemptive plan gives us a chance to always come back to you for confession of sin. We thank you for your words, for the teaching of it. Just ask, Lord, that you would bless all of these that have come here today. enable them to hear your word as you wish them to hear it so that they can grow spiritually. So this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We'll take a 10-minute break and see y'all back here in 10 minutes.
Recording in progress.
Father, we're just so grateful for the understanding that you are Lord, and we cannot make you Lord. You are already Lord, but we can't allow you to be Lord in our life. We ask you, Lord, to give us the grace and strength to submit to your will in every area of our life. In Christ's name, amen. At this time, we're dismiss the kids, and we're our First John study. Word of God is powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing the sun of the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrow, and is a creator of thoughts and intents of the heart. All scriptures God breathed and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction in righteousness, so that the man of God or the woman of God may be thoroughly furnished and equipped for every good work. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. If you will, open the word of truth to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. We're resuming our study of our series called Fellowship with God and Intimacy with Christ. And we're currently in 1 John chapter 4, verse 7 through 21. Today we'll be looking at verse 18 and we'll continue with the subject of brotherly love, And what we will do, we'll read our text for today. And I'm not going to read all the verses, but we're going to read verse 7 through 14. And then I come back and we'll resume our study of verse 8. We're going to start today with verse 8. But let's read verse 7 through 14 and then we'll come back. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and everyone of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love. By this, the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sin. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us his Spirit. We have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. In our last class, in verse 7, we see the command for us to join John in loving one another. We saw that John had already decided to love as Christ had loved. But then he say, for love is from God. God is a source of love. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. We saw in our last class that not only is God the source of true love, therefore a person without God cannot display true biblical love, because love, sacrificial love, has its source in God. Verse 8, the one who does not love does not know God, for God is love. Here in verse 8, John revealed the truth that knowledge of God is always practical. Let me say that again. Our knowledge of God is always practical, with the object of assimilation of that knowledge. So if I know God, then my actions should show that I know God, which is only possible through the new birth. The only way I can show love, I must be born again. Or as to Christian, we must be in fellowship or controlled by the Spirit to assimilate the love of God. So if I'm not born into the family of God, and if I'm not a believer in fellowship with God, I cannot assimilate the love of God in my dealings with mankind. The individual who is not loving, he showed that either he have not experienced the new birth, he have not been born again, or he's not fellowshipping intimately with Jesus Christ, nor controlled by the Spirit. If you recall in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, the fruit of the Spirit of God is love. So if I am walking intimate and close with Christ, then his life would naturally flow from me into the world in my relationships, because the fruit of the Spirit is love. So if I'm walking intimately in fellowship with God, then I will be showing love, his love. But if I am not, then I would not be able to assimilate the love of God. The Christian not loving is what? He's walking in disobedience. He's walking in disobedience. Now I want to look at this phrase here. God is love, right here in verse 8. God is love, okay? Why is this important to look at? I want to look at this phrase, God is love. Why is it important? It's important because the word God has an article in Greek. The article is like the. And so in Greek, it say the God love is. Anytime you see an article, it tells you that this is talking about the subject. The subject here is God, okay? So God has the article, and the word love don't have the article. So in other words, God is not just love. Love is part of his nature. It's part of who he is, as well as his righteousness and justice. So love is part of God's nature. So he can't do anything but love. He can't do anything but love. And as a believer, the moment you believe in Jesus Christ, the Spirit of God comes to live in you, and you have the nature of God in you. You are born again. But that nature would never be realized in your dealing with men or each other unless you're walking intimately and close with the indwelling Holy Spirit. So you can have the nature of God in you and it not even be realized in your practice and your dealings with one another, because you have to be in fellowship with the Spirit in order for the Spirit to make true in practice what is already true in your position in Christ. So I am already born again, but my lifestyle and my practice and my interaction with believers and others should show that I am born again. So if you're born again, then you should in practice new nature. And that one of the attributes of your new nature is the love of God. The love of God. The love of God. So it is God's nature to be loving. It is his nature to be loving. Everything that God does, all his attribute is involved. So love is what God is and what he does. No person among men is said to be love. Though we may love someone, but none of us is love inherently. We are given the love of God through the Spirit the moment we believe. None of us by nature is love. And the thing here is about God's love, God's love is superior than human love, because his love is part of his character and requires no response from the object of love. So love defines God. Human love requires a response from the object of your love. So if the object is not attractive, or if the object is not meeting your standard, or if the object is not a relative of yours, or if the object is not the same color as yours, therefore, in human love have conditioned to demonstrate a showing love. See, in human love, I only love those that are like me, or those who are the same color as me. Human love. Some people who don't have the love of God, that's how they function. Human love is, if you don't meet my standard, then therefore, you know, I'm not gonna, you know, show you, you know, selfless sacrificial love if you don't have nothing in it for me. That's human love. But God love is not like that. It is only through being born again and then being filled. See, when you're born again, when you believe in Jesus Christ, your Savior, you have the potential to love someone selfishly. That don't mean that you're going to automatically just love your wife selfishly. No. You got potential because you have the Spirit of God living in you. But now you need to walk in the Spirit. Now you need to allow the Spirit to control you for long periods of time. And in the Spirit will enable you to do what you're not even able to do on your own. So I have the potential of unconditionally and selflessly, but I must be controlled and filled by the Spirit. So the first step to loving as God loved, I must first get born again. The second step, once I'm born again, I need to not hinder the Holy Spirit that lives in me from controlling my life. Sin hinders the Holy Spirit from us displaying and showing love to one another. And once we sin, it's like the Holy Spirit hands become folded like this. In other words, he's there trying to work, but he can't work because sin is in our lives. So we have to confess our sin, and then the Holy Spirit gained back control of our life, and we need to live in constant fellowship. So if I stay in fellowship for long periods of time, the Holy Spirit is going to enable me to love, enable me to do what I can't do on my own. All of God's mandates in his word is designed to develop the love of God. Every mandate in the Word of God is designed to develop the love of God in you and through you. When the believer goes negative toward God's word, it leads to sin, and it cut off the power of the Spirit and put us under the control of the sin nature and Satan's influence. And it's like, and at that time, it's like taking a battery out of a car. All the believer have then is self-centeredness. Self become at the center of our life when you take that battery out of the car. When you take that battery out of the car, guess who's going to be the center of your life? You, self. Because you have no power to do anything different. That's why it's so important to stay in fellowship with the Holy Spirit. Because when you get out of fellowship through sin, and the battery been taken out of the car, and now self is going to be at the center. It ain't going to be about God anymore. It's not going to be about showing self-sacrificial love toward others. No, it's going to be about me. It is difficult to love others as God loved in Christ when we're out of fellowship, when we're influenced by Satan. Love is the character of God, and his character is developed over time as we maintain fellowship through our obedience to the word of God. What was God's proof that he loved us? What was his proof that he loved us? Look at the next verse, verse 9. By this, here's the proof. The love of God was manifested in us. That God sent his son, he sent his only begotten son into the world so that we might live through him. Now the word translated here, manifested, is aorist passive indicative of the word phairao. And it means to make clear or to make evident. Or to reveal. So God made clear, he made evident what we would not otherwise know. He made evident what we would not otherwise know. The word carried the idea of the manifestation of what was previously hidden. See, we would not even know how much God loves us unless God made that known to us. And he did. And he did make it known. He made known what was hidden. What did he do? What did God do and why did he do it? Let's look at what he did and why he did it. It says he sent his only begotten son into the world. That's what he did. He sent. And the word sent carries the idea of sending someone as your official authority for a specific, to do a specific task. God sent his representative in the world to do a specific task. God the Father sent his son, and we now enjoy the blessing of mission accomplished. What did Jesus say on the cross? It is finished. God the Father sent his official representative to do a specific task, go to the cross, die in man's place. And Jesus on the cross said, okay, Father, it is finished. And you know what that means? It is paid in full. The debt that men owe you, I just paid it. It's done. That is the love of God. That is God revealing or making clear and knowing what we would not otherwise know, his love for us. God made public clear his love toward us and sending his son so that what? We may live through him. So he sent his son to die for sinners. It was a love previously hidden in ages past, but made publicly clear at the cross. If you want to know the love of God for you, go to the cross. And until you go to the cross, you will not ever be able to love your wife as you're supposed to love her. You will not even be able to love your children. You'll not even be able to love anybody unless you start at the cross. Because there is where God has revealed his love for you and I. He has made it clear. At the cross, something that you would not otherwise know. I would not, you know, when I first came to understand the love of God at the cross, it changed me. I'm talking about it really, I'm like, man, it motivates everything that I do even today. Go to John 3, verse 14 through 15, the Gospel of John, not First John, but go back to the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 14 through 16. The Gospel of John, chapter 3, 14 through 16. The Gospel of John, chapter 3, verse 14 through 16. Verse 14 says, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that whoever believes in him have eternal life. For God so loved the world in mercy that he gave in grace his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved from the penalty of their sin through him. So here we have God revealing his love through sending his Son. Go to Romans chapter 5, verse 8. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. See, God did not just tell us he loved us. He showed us he loved us. Verse 8 says, but God demonstrates his own love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God's only and uniquely Son, a one-of-a-kind Son, went to the cross to die for our benefit, It was love in action so that we might live, as John says in 1 John. Go now, if you will, back to 1 John, chapter 4, verse 8, verse 9. And the purpose that God did this is so that, the Greek word here, so that is henna, it speaks of the purpose, so that we might live through him. That was the purpose that God sent his Son, and so that we may live. See, he gave of himself for our benefit. And then Christ willingly accomplished the Father's mission. That was his love for us. And the Holy Spirit enabled him and gave him the power he needed to endure all the suffering to actually do it. So actually at the cross, you see the love of the Trinity. You see the love of the Father. You see the love of the Holy Spirit. And you see the love of our Savior, Jesus Christ. You see the love of the Trinity at the cross. Verse 10, and this is love, not that we love God. This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and gave his only begotten. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sin. This is powerful. Here in verse 10, we see the quality of true love. Here in verse 10, we see the quality of true love. The word love here is the quality of love, and it's the word agape. You hear it all the time, agape. Agape is a selfless love. God did not manifest his selfless love because we loved him. It wasn't that he said, you know what, because y'all love me, I'm going to manifest my selfless love. No, that's not why he did it. He loved us and showed selfless love to us. He gave of himself our benefit when we were his enemies. So we're not to be going around saying, saying, I'm not going to love you unless you're friendly to me. No, because that's not what God did. It said, the scriptures say, and this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us. So our love for him is not what motivated us. I motivated him to show selfless love. So people may not even love us, but we're still obligated to show selfless love to them. They may not be kind to us. They may not meet our expectations. They may not be attractive. We do not motivate God through our action to love us. He loves us anyway because of his own character. We are to love others not because of their character. We are to love them because of who we are. Because of who we are as children of God. It is not our continuing loving God that should be the central, but the love revealed historically in Jesus Christ. What did God do historically in the past to reveal his love to us? We saw he sent his only begotten son to the world to be what? The propitiation for our sin. Let's look at this word propitiation. Now the word here translated propitiation is the Greek word ilasmos, I-L-A-S-M-O-S. And it means appeasement or satisfaction. Jesus Christ was the sacrifice of atonement for our sins. In other words, he atoned at the cross for our sins. And the Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there is no atonement for sin. He satisfied through his death the righteousness and justice of God the Father. Forgiveness of sin are available called Christ's atoning sacrifice. Go to Romans 3:25. Romans 3:25. In Romans 3:25, look at 23 through 25. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus, whom God displayed publicly as a propitiation in his blood through faith. This was to demonstrate his righteousness, because in the forbearance of God, he passed over the sin previously committed. Praise the Lord. Here, Jesus' blood at the cross satisfied the righteousness of God. Remember we said earlier, the righteousness of God rejects sin. The justice of God have to judge sin. But instead of us satisfying the, because we couldn't satisfy the righteousness of God, Jesus Christ went to the cross and died to satisfy the righteousness and justice of God. So those who trust in Christ's work are justified and declared righteous as though they have never sinned. Can I get an amen? That made me want to sing a song to y'all. It's called, I Knew It Was the Blood. I knew it was the blood that saved me. One day on the cross, Jesus died on the cross. I knew it was the blood that saved me. Oh boy. Don't y'all put me on anybody's record, okay? But I know it sounds beautiful to the Lord. So it was his blood. Because of his blood, God looks at me as though I have never sinned. Can you believe that? That is grace. Look at 2 Corinthians 5:21. 2 Corinthians 5:21. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, it says, he, God, made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So I have a right relationship with God because the one who is righteous and who was righteous satisfied the righteousness and justice of God at the cross. I am justified or declared righteous. Not because I was righteous in myself, but because the one who was righteous died for me and I am in him, and God therefore looked at me as though I have never sinned. Praise the Lord. There's the love of God right there. We escape the penalty of our sin, which is death, because of Christ's death. And because of his resurrection, we will be resurrected one day. Christ did not just atone for our sins as believers, but he atoned for all men's sin. Now, in closing, let us look at the inspiration of love. Let's go to verse 11. Go back to 1 John. 1 John chapter 4, verse 11. Now we'll go on and look at the inspiration of love. What should inspire us to love? That's what that means. Verse 11 say, beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. So here in verse 11, John gives the inspiration of love. So now that we understand God's love for us, we are obligated to show this selfless love of God toward one another. God the Father gave us a model to follow in how we are to love one another. He manifests his love by sending his son to atone for our sin. He now desires to continue to manifest that love through us, through our love for one another, through us giving of ourselves for the benefit of each other. That is us allowing God to continue to manifest his love to the world. No one in the human race should be beyond our love. No one. Since God sent his son for the world without any discrimination. The word translated here in this verse, all, means to be morally obligated, to owe someone a debt that must be paid. You are obligated. You are indebted to God. You are indebted to every believer in Jesus Christ. Why? Because God loved you. He gave of himself for your benefit. Now you are morally obligated to be patient, to give out of yourself to meet someone else's need in the body, to sacrifice for the well-being of others. We must show self-sacrificial love because it was shown to us in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are indebted to each other. The word all is used in other places in scripture to communicate the idea of indebtedness. In Romans 15:1, go to Romans 15:1. Romans 15:1. In Romans 15:1, Paul uses this word all, or indebtedness. Someone read, if you will, if you're there before me.
Now, we who are strong ought to bear the weakness of those without strength and not just please ourselves.
You see that word all? See, a lot of you, there's some believers here that are strong. You are spiritually mature. And we are to bear with those who are not spiritually mature, as mature as we are. And if you only thinking about yourself, then you will not bear with one another. Go to 16, Romans 16, 27. We are obligated to love and bear the weakness of our weaker brother. Romans 16, 27, we see the word all used here as well. Somebody read, if you will, please. 16, verse 27. Well, I may be, hold on now. All right, so hold on. Was it? I wrote this down wrong. I saw it somewhere. So in it may be six. Let me make sure. Maybe six. Let me see. No, it ain't. I got a feeling this Corinthians. We're not gonna look for it. I'm just gonna communicate the idea. So here's the idea. There's another, I think it's in Corinthians, where Paul used the word all, and he was showing the believer that they are financially obligated to those who brought them spiritual blessings. In other words, there were some believers, a church down in Jerusalem that was a poor Jewish church. We all are blessed because of the Jewish people, because our Savior came from that line. But then we have people in our lives that blesses us spiritually. And Paul said that we ought to be, we are financially obligated to be a blessing to those who have blessed us spiritually. Given to poor believers in Jerusalem were obligated by believers. In other words, those who God used to bless us, we are to be a blessing to them. Gentiles were encouraged to support the poor Jewish church of believers. So in other words, they were indebted to minister to them in material things. We too should sense a sense of indebtedness to those who have blessed us spiritually. Spiritual blessings are greater than material blessings. Husbands are indebted to love their wives as their own bodies because Christ have loved the church. And in second, I close with this one. Go to 2 Thessalonians 1:3. In 2 Thessalonians 1:3, Paul feel indebted to give thanks for these believers in his prayer. What gave him that sense of indebtedness to give thanks for these believers? Let's see, and then we'll stop. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3. Someone read, if you will, please. Amen. So when Paul went into his prayer, he felt morally and socially obligated to give thanks to God. God, their faith was growing. Their love for each other was growing to new spiritual heights. Paul and others were speaking proudly. They were in a lot of suffering and affliction in their life, but guess what? That did not stop them from love to one another. So, I feel morally obligated. When we show self-sacrificial love to people, guess what they're going to do? They're going to say, God, I thank you. God, for your self-sacrificial love, guess what that does? That is so when we love the other, they go to God. You see how important it is to allow God to love others? Because you are still in the reward. When we love others selflessly, whatever way God calls us, they get it. And that works for you. Husband, when you feel morally obligated to love your wife and try to love the church, do it. Lord, thank you so much. He's a and when she gives, that is reward. Man, since I put you on the spot, can you close us out in prayer?
It's that fellowship. May we take your word and just not only hear it, but put it in action. You know? So I thank you so much for who you are. Lord, you are a perfect God. Hold this entire world.
Amen. Y'all are dismissed. See you next week, Lord willing.